Hey guys, we are in the basement, and today, yes, today guys, we're gonna do one of those John gets a new game videos, and yes, I know what you're gonna say, John, stop it, you don't need any more projects, your garage is overflowing, and yes, I agree with you, the last thing I need to do is stick another project in that garage. However, you know, I kind of have this little mental checklist of stuff I want to accomplish in the hobby, stuff I want to learn, you know, kind of like a bucket list, if you will, okay? And one of those things is owning and working on and fixing an EM, either pinball machine, electromechanical pinball machine, or gun game, okay? So the last few years, I have been casually, and I mean casually, looking for some sort of an electromechanical game, pinball, gun, whatever it is, okay? And I've been waiting for a deal, like a real deal, because I don't want to spend a lot of money because honestly, again, I don't have any nostalgia for this stuff. I didn't really grow up with the EM stuff, and I don't remember playing it. I kind of remember playing EM pinball machine at campgrounds and stuff, but really, it didn't make a big impression on me like the video games did, because in the 70s, when I was in campgrounds playing games, I was playing Asteroids and Space Invaders. I wasn't putting the quarters in the EM pinball machines, so I don't really have that nostalgia. And I know it, before too, I've said that I don't really like old pinball machines because they're slow and boring, and again, no nostalgia. And I know recently I even said I wouldn't want to put a pinball machine down here that's older than Whirlwind, and I believe that still to be true. However, I kind of respect the technology, the engineering behind these electromechanical games, because it's amazing that these things work, because again, they're electromechanical. This is before solid state. There was no CPUs, no computers. Everything was kept track with gears and reels and solenoids and relays. It's just crazy stuff. And I have no concept how any of this stuff works. And I think it would be a really fun learning experience for me and maybe for you guys to kind of work on this stuff. You know, this is a new frontier. So anyway, I've been looking on Craigslist, you know, casually the last few years, and when I see an EM listing that catches my eye, I click on it, I look at it, is this a good deal? Usually it's not, okay? But in the last week here, a machine showed up on Craigslist, a 1970s Gottlieb EM pinball machine, and it was a really great deal, great price. I'm like, that's the deal you've been looking for, okay? So I emailed the guy, I actually offered him a little bit less, and he replies back, and he didn't say no to my price, but he did say, however, it was sold. And I'm like, ah, rats. But he did say in the email that, you know, if the guy doesn't come to pick it up, I'll let you know you're next in line, okay? So a few days have passed, and then this morning, I'm checking my emails, the guy emails me and says, John, the guy flaked out, he didn't show up. If you want the pinball machine, it's yours, okay? And this is like 20 minutes ago, okay? So I emailed him, I said, fine, no problem. I'll be there like, you know, within the next couple hours, I'll take it. So guys, we're gonna hop in the car and we're gonna go grab this game. Yeah, it's a 1970s EM pinball machine. I don't know what to expect. I've never worked on these things, but I think it's a nice little challenge and I'm actually kind of excited about it. So anyway, enough of that. Let's get in the car and let's go pick up this 1970s Gottlieb EM pinball machine. All right guys, let's hit the road. ladies, here it is. Yes, yes, I am now an EM guy. I am an electromechanical guy. Anyway, this is a 1977 Gottlieb Bronco. Now, admittedly, I don't know really a lot about this at all, okay? But, you know, I have secretly wanted an EM pinball machine for a while. Now, I know that I have always said that I thought these games were slow and boring, and I have no nostalgia for them, and that's actually 1,000% true. But I thought it would be fun, and also kind of a final frontier of arcade collecting, to get an EM game. And I've been looking like at EM gun games and pinball machines, and I've really just been waiting and waiting and waiting for the deal, and this was it right here. This thing showed up on Craigslist. It was dirt cheap, guys. It was super cheap. Now, the thing does not work at all, and it's gonna be a fun little challenge to try to fix this thing. And actually, in this video, I'd like to see if we can maybe get this thing to come to life, because right now, when you plug it in, it just lights up, and I'll show you guys that in a second. So anyway, yeah, this thing showed up on Craigslist. I went to the guy's house. He said this game has been in their family forever. It was his wife's pinball machine, I guess, when she grew up, and they've been just traveling with it from house to house, and it was just time to get rid of it. And the thing stopped working at some point, so I have no idea what's gonna happen. Now, first of all, the condition-wise, it's okay. It's not bad. I mean, it's 1977, so for its age, I would say it's in pretty okay shape. The back glass, not perfect. Some spidering, some cracks, stuff like that. But I love the artwork. Just look at that art. I mean, this is so cool. I mean, this is the type of stuff that was around when I was a kid. You know, when I was going to the campgrounds with my parents, which I did like almost every weekend, we went camping when I was a kid. You know, and every campground would have a game room. You know, and I would typically play, you know, Space Invaders or Asteroids. I really didn't gravitate towards these games, but this is exactly the type of pinball machine that was in those campgrounds when I was a kid, and every now and then I would drop a quarter into them, but I really never fully understood pinball or got into it till much later in life. But anyway, this will be a fun little challenge, and you know, looking at the playfield, wow, the playfield's actually in really good shape. Which is a miracle for how old this thing is, because these old pinball machines, they just put like a very thin lacquer finish on these playfields. They didn't clear coat them like with an automotive type clear coat like Bally Williams did in the 90s. So these had a very thin, you know, clear coat lacquer finish on them, and usually these playfields are all blown out, and really, this looks really, really good. So I think the first thing that I want to do is I want to clean this thing up a little bit, because it's kind of grossing me out, I have to admit. There's definitely some evidence of mice that were inside this thing at some point. Now, the guy I got it from, he had it like in a garage type, almost like a garage barn. So I just really want to wipe this thing down, because I'm going to be touching this, and I'm going to use Simple Green, which is a lot more mild than Mean Green. This is almost more like a dish soap, where Mean Green has a little more stuff in it. So let's just kind of do a test area here and see what happens. And not too bad. I mean, it looks like it has like, you know, it's kind of yellowed. I would imagine this used to be kind of a nice bright white. And maybe we'll try a little bit of Mean Green if the Simple Green doesn't work too well. But it doesn't look like this is lifting up the artwork, which I'm worried about, because this is the original silkscreen artwork on the sides there. We definitely don't want to mess with that, and it's in pretty good shape, really. So let's just kind of wipe this thing down, because if I'm touching this thing, I don't want to be grossed out by it. And I'm just going to go around the whole game. I don't know if it's getting cleaner. I mean, there's definitely stuff coming off. I'm going to try just a little bit of Mean Green on here and see if this makes a bit of a difference. Now, Mean Green is kind of like a dollar store generic Simple Green, but it is, I think, a little stronger, a lot stronger than Simple Green. So let's see what happens with this stuff. I'm gonna wipe it off fairly quick. I don't wanna eat up this silkscreen at all. Let's see if we get more stuff off. Oh, looks like it's not affecting the paint. So we'll just go around the game real quick and just wipe it down before we turn it on and work on it. Because I don't think this thing's been touched in a long time. Wow, that does look whiter already, doesn't it? I could tell this area here looks whiter. That's pretty good. So I'm going to go around the game and just clean it up with Simple Green, and then we'll go to the next step. We'll be right back. guys, we are all clean. So I simple, actually mean green the whole game. Took some Windex, cleaned the glass, cleaned the back glass. It's looking pretty good. So, all right. So what's going to happen now? I don't really know. So we got to plug this thing in and just see what's happening. And of course, again, this is electromechanical, meaning this is not, there's no solid state anything in this. There's no computer. There's no brains. You know, this game all works with solenoids and coils. And it's really just a marvel of engineering, honestly. I mean, look back here. I mean, this is what makes this game tick, guys, you know. So we've got all these coils that fire for the score reels. We've got all these leaf switches. So this is all stuff that we're going to have to clean if that's what the problem is. I believe this here is what the kids call a stepper motor that has all these contacts. This thing rotates and makes various different contact with different points on here, which tells the thing to do different stuff. In general, it all looks pretty original. I don't see any hack jobs, which is one of the things I looked for when I went to go look at this game, because I really didn't want an EM machine, my first EM machine, to be one that was hacked up a lot, okay? So this is just in the back box, and then also on the underneath the playfield is all kinds of relays and switches too that we're gonna have to address. But I think, why don't we at least turn it on and see what it's doing? Because when I was at the guy's house, we plugged it in, and you know, whenever I'm at someone's house, when I'm buying a game on Craigslist, I usually don't attempt to fix anything. So I just kind of let the owner do his thing, and then that's it. So he plugged it in, and it lit up, and that was all that we saw, and I was okay with that, you know. All right, so we plug it in, and it lights up, okay? See that? The back glass is lit up. It does look pretty cool, guys. So, and when it's lit up, it really does show off the flaws in the back glass. So I don't know. I mean, if this turns into a game I end up keeping for a long time, maybe I'll try to find a new back glass. But for now, this will be good enough. Maybe we'll triple thick it to preserve it. But first things first, though, we got to get this thing working. So right now, the play field's just dark, okay, and nothing's really happening. And if we credit the game, it should start. I mean, that's... So here's the start button, but there's no credits on the game. So to credit it, now I gotta be careful in here because on these older pinball machines, they used AC voltages. And I think they're fairly low and safe AC voltages, but so I'm just gonna credit this thing up here. Let's see, where's the, just trying to find the little mech here. Here we go. So it's not coining up at all because there's a little zero in the back glass, which I believe is the credits, okay? The credit reel right there, okay? And so it's not doing anything. And if I start the game, if I push this button, nothing happens. And we're not getting any credits at all. So now what? Well, I don't really know. So I'm trying to credit it. I did do a little bit of research online. Because Clay, who's pinrepair.com, and his videos, by the way, this old pinball are excellent. And if you guys like my videos, go seek his videos out. It's thisoldpinball.com. But his videos are on DVD, and I've actually purchased all of them. And I'll be probably re-watching the EM one now because I have one of these games. But anyway, I did some brief research, and he talks about this AX and BX relay system that's in here. And so I think we're gonna look at that right now. So if I turn it on and off, nothing's happening. Actually, why does this close here? Is that supposed to close? So look at that, when you turn the game on, this little relay down here closes. It's kind of interesting. Not sure what the purpose of that is. Watch this, when we turn this on, that thing closes. I'm guessing it's supposed to do that. Okay, it's part of the boot sequence. So I think that we should probably test fuses. I'm gonna unplug the game. This game does scare me a little bit. Just because this is uncharted territory and I have zero experience working on these games. I mean, I've never worked on one of these ever in my life. So this is all new. We're learning together for the first time. But I don't know why, I just feel confident that we can get it working. And it seems like right now, what the state that it's in, where it's doing nothing is, I think, a good sign. I like games like that, okay? Because there's one thing that is preventing this game from working right now, and I feel like I need to find that one thing, and it's gonna come to life. All right, so let's lift the play field up, okay? And we'll take this bar. This game definitely has a musty smell, by the way. So we'll prop the play field up like so, okay? So let's take a peek inside here, and you guys can see it's really crazy, right? I mean, there's so much stuff going on. It's a little intimidating. It's actually a lot intimidating, all right? So we've got three fuses right here. We definitely want to test those. Now, there's like an AX reset control relay right here that I think needs to be adjusted properly, otherwise the game will not reset and get into that ready to play status. And that relay is right here, AX reset control relay. And I think you can manually trip it. Yeah, okay, so it's this guy right here. And we might last ball relay, which is the other one, the BX. And what this is there's a coil and then like four leaf switches. And then when the coil fires, it makes all four of those leaf switches make contact. So there's a lot of moving parts there that need to all line up properly. I'm just curious if I can manually. I could tell these switches aren't, they're not lined up right in here. They're supposed to be in all these blades. I think that there's an issue right here. I wonder how this thing comes out of here. Again, guys, I've never worked on these, all right? We're learning together. I could tell that this piece of plastic, the blades are not in it properly. Same with that one. There, now it's in. Okay. All right, so let's see if we can get this one. Get the blades in all the slots on that little plastic guy. I know I need to check the fuses. We'll do that, but let me see if I can show you guys a little closer what's going on in here. But these blades go into that little plastic thing, and then when the coil fires, it moves the plastic thing that then engages all of these leaf switches, and I could tell that the leaf switches have popped out of the plastic piece. So I want to get those back in, and I wonder if there's an easy way to pull this out of here. It does look pretty clean down here, which is good. Oh, I think it just popped in. Did it? Nope. I really want to take this off. I think I need to pull a pin and then it comes off. Yeah, there's a little cotter pin on here. Right there. So we'll pull that out. And then this should hopefully come off. Okay. So you could see these blades are not in the slots. This could be the whole problem right here. Wouldn't that be amazing? So there's two sides to this. So this one blade looks like it's in the wrong slot. Okay. So I'm not sure if they should all be open or close when it's in this position. Something tells me they should all be open. Oh, I see. Okay, well, it's moving really nice. So I'm curious now to see if that made a difference at all. So let's put that back in its spot. So I'm gonna go ahead and put that pin back in the back. I probably should get some pliers. It's kind of a tight little spot. This one doesn't look right to me. All right, I'm gonna put the pin back in and let's see what happens. All right, I got that thing back in there properly. And I also pulled out the BX1, which I guess it says here is the last ball relay. And there's also Q somewhere, which is game over. But just based on the really quick research I did, the AX and BX are kind of what causes these games to fail. So I'm kind of betting on that a little bit, but I really do need to test the fuses because that's irresponsible if we don't. So I'm gonna put it on continuity beep here and we're just gonna see if the fuses are good. If it beeps, they're good. It's good, good, good. All right, all our fuses are good. And I'm just looking around down here and by the way, this is the chimes. Isn't that cool? So those things fire and that's how you get the sound effects. Awesome. So what's down here? Any surprises? So we have the original manual, which is nice. And all kinds of little literature here. Wow, that's cool. So there's a lot of little goodies down here. What's this piece? That doesn't look good. So let's just get this stuff out of the way for now. We'll clean this up later. There's actually some quarters in here. And it looks like there's a little bit of mouse feces in here. We'll vacuum this out later. I'm not going to put my hand in there and touch those quarters. This tilt ball thing is missing. I don't know if that's a problem for us, but there should have been a captive ball down here for the tilt, I believe. I'm guessing that that's not a big deal. All right, let's just try this again and see if anything is different. I think I'm going to start the game with the playfield up. I'm not sure there's a problem doing that. Nah, let's lower it. All right, and then the ball, I actually pulled the ball out before I moved the game. So let's go ahead and put the ball in. All right, let's plug it in and see what happens. Let's turn it on. Oh my God. Get out of here. Did I just fix this pinball machine? Look at it, it's resetting. Everything's going to zero. Oh my God, if I just fix this, I am gonna lose my shit. Sorry. All right, I don't know if it's on free play, if there is free play. Let me coin it up here. Oh my God. All right. Let's see the score. It doesn't seem like it's getting credits. Oh, now it has one on it. Look at that. It's resetting everything to zero. I'm guessing the ball is gonna eject in a second, maybe. Is it stuck on something? No, look at that. The flippers work. Oh, that didn't sound right. Man, is this game slow. Not hearing the chimes. That's a problem. So, looks like we're partially working. Those are firing. So, it's working. The chime unit is not working. Doesn't know what's going on there. So, it's supposed to kick that ball out, I imagine. So, looks like we've got past one hurdle, but we have many more hurdles. So there's a kick out here. Let's see. And that's, what is this little dead end here? That's another kick out, that's not working. It's not keeping score either. All right, so we're obviously far from out of the woods here. Boy, that was exciting. You have to admit, when that thing fired up. That was pretty darn exciting. All right, let's see what happens when the ball goes in. If it recognizes that that happened. No, it doesn't. Okay, now what? Good question. So it doesn't know the ball's in there. Oh boy, I almost have to do some research here because now I don't know what else to look at. I think we got past one hurdle, which is really, really exciting. We gotta open this up again. Now I know there's like a stepper motor back here and there's one in the bottom. I don't know if I need to clean those, if these are not spinning. I think this is more for the scoring though. There's score adjustments up here. I don't really know what I'm looking at, but I'm trying to figure it out. Game adjustment right here. That's interesting. Not sure what that's all about. There's like these little almost like crude dip switches. So when you have it in this socket, it says credit. Oh, I see. So when you get a high score, you get a credit, or you can move it over here to get an extra ball. Here's an option for match feature. So what do we do right now? And then this thing here, all these contacts should be cleaned. I want to make sure the game's off before I start putting my finger around the back here. All right, I'm going to unplug it. Let's poke a little bit more underneath the playfield, see if we can find or figure out anything else. I might actually look at that. So it wasn't registering, the chime unit was not working. You know, this might be something, you know, where I do some research and we come back at another video. Okay, so the chime unit was not making any noise whatsoever, and which is over here, and that's a bummer because, I mean, the game's all about the chimes. And so I'm just kind of looking around there. Oh shit, ball's rolling out in the driveway. I'm chasing the ball down my driveway. Stop! I don't know if you guys can still hear me. All right, so. Okay, so the chime unit's over here. I'm just looking for connections and just simple stuff first, you know. And there's coils that fire. So we got this stepper motor right here that I'm not sure if it's advancing properly. And then down in here is another one of these motors. So I don't know if that's correct operation. Two coins, three plays, relay. I'm just guessing now, guys. I'm curious to see what happens again if we turn it on, if we get any kind of different symptoms. I don't know if I should look at this other relay again, this BX. That's the last ball relay. U is the first ball. Oh wow, there's relays for everything. Second shoot, ball shooter, tilt, hold. So really, we gotta go through all of these, I think, and just make sure they're all set up right. This one, I'm gonna close that one, and that one. So there's a Ball, so there's all kinds of relays for every little function. Game over, first ball, ball return, second shoot, add player start, bonus score, tilt, ball shooter. So I guess when it rolls over a switch or something, one of these relays will go off, you know, depending on which switch, right? Right hole. Okay, all right, it's all starting to kind of make sense. So I'm assuming that that was working because that was part of the reset, I think. The game was zeroing out. It's just that the chimes weren't working. And this thing... Oh, whoa, whoa, whoa. Look at this. Is that a bare wire? This wire? What's going on here? All right, we got a wire disconnected. I just found something. There's a loose wire right here. Okay, I think this might have been soldered to here. So that's something. Naked cloth wire. I wonder what that's supposed to do. Let me research this real quick. Okay, guys, I was underneath the playfield just kind of manually moving the reels, just kind of like, you know, activating the coil manually just to see if the reel would move freely, and really they weren't. And then I just kind of just turned it back on, and then look at this. The chimes are working now. So I don't know what's up with that. So I think it just registered that ball. Yeah, look at that. And it just kicked out a ball for a second player. So... And it's keeping score now. I don't think it's keeping score properly, but it's keeping score. Look at that. All right, let's see if it kicks that. Oh, it's kicking that out. Oh, everything's working now. I think we need to just take this thing apart and just clean every little part. And I think those reels is where I need to focus my attention. Boy, that thing's not level. So right now it's doing a two-player game, and we obviously have a lot of light bulbs out. Where's the ball? Oh, the ball's stuck here. I gotta clean the play field. But it's kinda working now. Yeah, it's totally working. And it's kicking the ball out of the holes. Now, the one bad thing about this game, and I knew that going in, is that these slingshots don't work. Boy, it's going nuts. I don't know if that's right or wrong. Something is clearly wrong. Why is he doing that? Is something stuck? I think these drop targets were sticking. What do you guys think of this? This thing's kind of neat. It'd be fun to get this all clean and level and working, and I think really it's just going to be cleaning all that stuff down there. Not very good. I do like that it's advancing the balls. It still says ball in play one, though. It's not advancing the balls. So we need to figure out, like, which stepper unit is in charge of that. Cool chime sounds, though. Let's turn it off. I'm curious to see if I turn it off right now and turn it back on, what's going to happen. Yeah, see, now it's stuck again. So I really do think it's something with that stepper unit, with the AX. I wonder if I manually... Yeah, see... It's that AX relay. I just manually, the score wheel's stuck up there. So it's trying to zero everything out, but that one was kind of stuck. So everything just needs to be cleaned. All right, let's see if we can start a game. All right, so now see that little score thing? It says one there. So we should be able to start a one-player game. So it's going through the motions and resetting everything. And then it kicks the ball out when it thinks everything is zeroed out. Let's see if our chimes work again. No. Oh, yeah, they're working. Okay. Well, I think we're pretty close. I think that we need to just spend a day out here taking this thing apart and cleaning all of the moving parts, because there's those reels that I think are our problems. And I think if we take them apart and clean them up, this thing will be probably rock solid. And then also I need to really adjust that AX relay. But it looks like everything's pretty much working. It's just a little gummy. This will be a fun game. I think I might keep this in the garage. We'll see. I gotta adjust the angle on this thing because it's slow. I want this thing to be fast. So what do you guys think, huh? Not bad, right? I mean, just trust me, this thing was dirt cheap. So it's pretty fun. I gotta tell you, I am super jazzed that we got this thing almost working. I really didn't know what I was doing, and I just really read something really quick online talking about the AX and BX relays. And it looks like we gotta get that just adjusted just right, and then it'll reliably reset itself every time I turn it on. Now, I noticed, though, it's definitely not counting the ball in play. So there's probably some kind of a stepper thing that does that. And I need to figure out which one it is. And we probably gotta clean it up. Because what we're gonna do in a later video is we're gonna just start taking stuff apart and cleaning it. Like this thing back here. I know that we need to take this apart and clean up all these contacts, because this thing spins around and makes contact with all these little points back here. And if this is gummed up and it doesn't move freely and it doesn't make contact, I think this wreaks a lot of havoc. So we're gonna have to do that. So this is the player unit, it says. All right, so that selects the different players, okay. Gotcha. And then this right here is the credit unit right here. And this thing's gummed up. See, look at that. See, it's not advancing the reel. So we're gonna have to take that apart and clean it up. Because it should be advancing this little score reel in here. And that's how it keeps track of how many credits you have. And so right now I just coined up the game a little bit. And then in here, all of these reels, that's for the score. I don't know, I can kind of get into this stuff. Don't know why it's not recording the right ball in play though. I'm gonna reset the game. Let's turn it back on. See, it's not doing it. So, but if I manually come in here and hit that AX, I bet you it'll come to life. Yep. So it's got 5 credits in there. So it's going through the motions. It's got to reset the score to 0. So that last one's a little sticky. See that? It's trying to get that last 9. And it's sticky. Come on. Do it. And I want to burn that coil up. Let me see if I can manually adjust that 9. Right there. There you go. Okay. So we don't have credits. Let's come in here, give ourselves some credits. So that credit reel has not advanced at all. It's trying to. So like when I hit it, that little number there should go to one. And it takes a couple tries for it to actually get there. There, now it got it. So that's a little gummy too. So it's just resetting itself, zeroing itself out. I don't know if this is taking longer than normal, but it does eventually get there and then kick the ball out. So what do you guys think? Do you like this EM stuff? I'm so happy those chimes are working. I have no idea how I fixed that. I was just moving stuff around. So it's on ball one. I wanted to advance to ball two. It's not. It still says ball one. I'm curious which relay controls the ball. So we've got a bit of a raised insert right there. So anyway, I think we'll stop here. I just kind of wanted to introduce you guys to this new project and really introduce myself to this new project. And I'm pretty stoked though, because I got a lot farther than I thought I was gonna get. You know, having never had one of these games before, the fact that this thing is remotely alive is, well, kind of exciting. You gotta admit. I mean, wow. It's kind of working, kind of. And we'll clean this thing up real good inside and out. I mean, we're gonna clean up the play field. I'll get some Novus. Maybe we could do that right now. Do I have any Novus downstairs? I don't think I do, actually. I should go. I'm curious to see what would happen if we clean this up, how white this would get. Yeah, let me get some cleaning stuff real fast. All right, I went in the basement and I grabbed this. This is Mills Wax. Pinball Playfield Wax and Cleaner, one-step wax polish, cleans, waxes, protects. You could buy this Marco Specialties. I'm just curious if we can get this a little bit whiter. Let's just see what happens. We'll just do this really quick. I'm just really curious to see how clean, and I'm gonna squirt it directly on here, not the playfield. And this is a brand new cleaning cloth. I buy these at Marco Specialties. Probably should turn the game off. And it looks like someone spilled a Coke in here or something. It's all gummy in the little the shooter rail. All right. So let's just come in here and just clean this thing up. Novus is really good for cleaning first, but I don't have any on hand, so we'll just use this stuff. And then when I wax my play fields, at least my my games downstairs, I usually just use an automotive carnauba wax. This stuff isn't really like a wax. It's more of a cleaner. But yeah, look at it. It's really cleaning the play field. Should we do a complete teardown on this? But you could see it's looking really clean already. You know, I don't think this game's gonna be a ton of work. I think that we just need to spend a weekend in the garage taking all those moving parts apart and just cleaning them up and then putting them back together. I think that's gonna fix this, that would fix this thing up. It's already, I can see it's already getting a lot of the marks off. Like in here, it's just kind of like ball wear. So yeah, I think this thing's gonna clean up pretty great. This is really, this play field's in fantastic shape. So, all right, well, I'll clean the rest of this on my time, but I think this is gonna be a fun little project. I hope you guys are enjoying it. Kind of different for us. Not a video game. And not really electronic. I guess it's kind of electronic. But we're gonna have to replace all the rubbers on this. You can see right here, someone put like a hairband in there, which is kind of funny. See that? That's just like a little hairband. It's not even a rubber band. I know the old timers called these things rubber bands. And they took it kind of literally there with that. kind of dig this, man. I love the artwork. So, all right, guys, that's going to do it. I hope you enjoyed the video. This is going to be a fun little project, a little side distraction. Yes, I know. I clearly have ADD or something here because we have a lot of simultaneous projects going, and Quantum really needs to be the biggest priority because winter is coming, guys. It's almost October already. So, but I just couldn't pass this up. I really thought it would be fun to work on and just really different and really a final frontier for us in the hobby. I mean, we've kind of climbed most video game mountains, you know, and so I'm going to be looking for, you know, new challenges and just things that are different and interesting as we go forward. But obviously, my heart is always going to be in the video game stuff. But I just couldn't pass this up. I thought it was too fun. And I think it's really neat, super neat. And I just like it a lot. So who knows? Maybe I will become an EM guy. You know, I'll just sell all my vids and get a basement full of electromechanical pinball machines. No, I'd never do that. But I think having one will be fun. I have no idea where this is going to go. You know, maybe I'll pull a vid out and bring this down. I'm not going to get rid of one of my pinball machines, I'll tell you that. That's not happening. I would not replace the Whirlwind NBA Fast Break or Revenge from Mars with a EM pinball machine. But I might consider replacing one of my vids with this thing. If I get this thing really working and it's rock solid and reliable and it is a true dream to play, I think I'm going to consider bringing this into the basement because I think it's just kind of neat. So anyway, all right, that's it. I hope you guys enjoyed it. Let's go down in the basement. We'll do some viewer mail and hang out for a little bit. And yeah, we got ourselves an EM pinball machine. All right, guys, let's go back to the basement. It is cool, though, you have to admit, so. All right, guys, there you have it. That was the 1977 Gottlieb Bronco pinball machine. So what'd you think? Are you guys going to like this little restore series, whatever you want to call it? You know, it's very different for us, and I think it's kind of cool, actually, because these electromechanical games are just so neat and so different. You know, I've never touched this kind of stuff before, so I'm actually really into it. So I hope you guys enjoyed it, because I can't wait to get back out in the garage and just start tinkering with that thing. And really, that's what it's all about with these EM games. It is tinkering, you know, it's getting stuff into adjusting things so they're just right, getting things lined up, cleaning things, you know, very different than working on these video games where you're messing around with power supplies and PCBs and EEPROMs and all that stuff. This is a very mechanical device, so I'm looking forward to it. I hope you guys enjoyed it. So anyway, all right, I want to do some viewer mail. And by the way, if you guys want to participate in the viewer mail segment, you need to email them to me at blkdog7@gmail.com. That's blkdog7@gmail.com. It is hot down here. In the subject line, please put viewer mail. Okay. All right. First one's from Charles. Hello, John. I found a Lethal Enforcer's cabinet, and the cab powers on, and the screen warms up to a set of scrambled images, almost like the image is condensed, and there is a slanted horizontal pattern, okay? When you press the button, it appears the scrambled images is responding or changing. Do you think this is a video monitor issue setting, or do you think it's the PCB? P.S. I love the show. I keep up the good work, Chip. Okay, so... All right, so you have a condensed picture, okay? I'm guessing like smooshed like this, and that you could see that the picture's moving inside of it, meaning the PCB is working, I'm guessing. So to me, this sounds like a monitor issue, okay? And I would start with the obvious easy stuff first, like adjusting knobs. I don't know, is it collapsed? Or, because if it's collapsed, you probably want to do a cap kit, and really, that is, first try to adjust it with the knobs, okay? The horizontal hold, the vertical hold, the horizontal size. Try to see if you can adjust that out. This, you know, could it be a sync issue? Is it a size issue? Try to adjust that out with the knobs. And then if that doesn't fix it, I really do think you're gonna need to do a cap kit, at least start there. Because if you have collapsed, that could be a cap kit. But I mean, with these monitors, you know, they're 30 years old. You just start with the simple stuff first, which is the capacitor, you know, replacing all the capacitors. And I know that everyone says that, you know, it's very cliche. You know, it is a very cliche answer. You know, it looks like you need a cap kit. But you know what? From my experience, 9 times out of 10, that is the answer. So I suspect that the monitor is all original. I would really try to figure out which model you have. Order a cap kit from Ian Kellogg at iankellogg.com or Bob Roberts, and replace the caps on that thing. That's right. If you can't adjust it with the knobs, I think you need to do a cap kit, because it sounds like you might have some kind of collapse. And collapse could be other stuff too, but just start with the caps, okay? All right, next one's from Scott. And so we got all kinds of internet monitor problems here this week. I'll do my best to help you guys. This is from Scott. Hey John, thanks for all the videos. Although your voice drives my wife crazy and you drain my internet data limit each month, I can't stop watching in case I miss something I might need to know about and caring for my cabs. But in this case, I haven't seen or couldn't find anything on diagnosing this problem. One of my Red Tent monitors has a whirl click 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 sound when I turn it on. It was fine one day, and then the next day I got this. The monitor was recapped and calibrated about 5 months ago. It does play blind, and the other side is fine. Some people think I need a new flyback. Others think it's the yoke. Please check out the attached video and let me know your thoughts. All right, let's play Scott's video here and see what's going on with this Red Tent monitor, which is a Sharp XM1801 or whatever. So, all right, let's play the video. All right, so we have a Red Tent here, and so I guess there's some kind of sound that's coming from it, which I can't really tell. But it looks to me, the picture, is this a tube issue? Something is messed up. It doesn't look like a flyback issue to me. Now, however, though, a bad flyback, you'll get some ticking because it will arc. You know, if it has a crack in it, it'll go tick, almost like a tick sound, but it's an arcing sound. But usually when that happens, the pitcher still looks okay, but when it arcs, the pitcher will jump. Now this looks like something else here. It looks like it could be a tube issue. I suppose it could be a yoke issue. Boy, I don't know, man. This is kind of a tough one. I've never seen this same exact thing before. All right, here's what we're gonna do. You could kind of deduce what's going on here. You know, you could swap the chassis between the two tubes to see if you get the same end result. Okay, that way you know, is it a tube issue or a chassis issue? Because you've got two monitors right there. You got two of the same monitor. I know it's a pain in the butt. It would be a lot of work, but you know, pull both monitors out and swap the chassis around. If the problem moves, then you know it's a problem on the chassis. If the problem stays, then you know it's a tube issue, okay? But I've never seen that exact issue before. I sure hope it's not that yoke. You could pull the yoke wires off, okay? The yoke has a connector that goes to the chassis. You could pull that off and you could measure it with your multimeter, put it on ohms, and see what kind of resistance you get. And then you could compare it to the other monitor. I mean, it's really nice. You got two of the same monitor right there, right? So you could pull the yoke wires off the chassis, put your multimeter in there and measure the different wires, and then compare that to your other one and see if you get the same resistance. You could have a short in there. I don't know. If anyone has any ideas for Scott, let him know. Post in the video right here. But Scott, I've never seen that issue. Maybe we could work together to help you figure it out, or better yet, maybe join the John's Arcade forums and we could talk about it there. Go to johnsarcade.com and join the forums. All right. Oh, this next one here is cut off. What happened here? Let me go check my printer. All right, our next viewer mail is from Mean Streak, okay? He says, "Hi John, I have been watching your show now for a while. I just purchased my first arcade machine. I got a nice Donkey Kong cabinet. Needs a little bit of work, but not. I just did my first cap kit and it really wasn't that bad, just time consuming. I was wondering if I should repaint the cabinet. It has some dings in it. If I do decide to redo it, do you happen to know what blue paint matches the best? Let me know. But thank you for doing these videos. I had you on this while I was doing a cap kit. Helped out a lot and you do an awesome job. I don't think I would have gotten this game if it wasn't for you doing these videos and showing all of us that we can keep these older arcade games going. If you ever come across the game Venture, Could you do a video playing it? That was one of my favorite ColecoVision games when I was a kid. I think I've seen one in your Fun Spot videos, but I didn't think. Anyway, thank you so much, man. Keep up the good work. Okay, so he sent me some pictures of his Donkey Kong, and I looked at them on my computer. I know. This is really a cheesy way to do it, but whatever. But you know what? Your Donkey Kong looks great, man. I would not paint that thing. No way. No, I would not paint it. I noticed the bottom, the base is raw wood. It looked like someone replaced the base and didn't paint that. I would definitely paint the base, but the sides I thought looked really good. It was a little chewed up in the edges, okay? I noticed that you need some new T-molding, okay? That's all chewed up. But really, dude, I don't see anything really significantly horrible with the blue paint on this thing. It looks like you need new T-molding and you need to paint the base black, and that should just be black and that's it. So that's what I would do. You know, if you've got some splinters and stuff on the sides, because it's delaminating a little bit from the particle, from the plywood, I'd leave that alone, okay? If most of it is nice and blue, leave it alone, man. Don't mess with it. Leave the original blue. That blue finish on Donkey Kong's is impossible to recreate, because it's so smooth. It's like this weird gel marine paint job or something. I don't even know what it is, but just leave it alone. Replace the T-molding. Paint the base black and call it a day. And you know what? You got a little bit of patina on there. So what? So, all right, guys. That's going to do it for this video. And by the way, my Robotron is flipping out over here. I don't know what's going on with this thing. It keeps resetting, and this is a new problem. This problem actually started developing. It actually happened the first time when Ian Kellogg was here. And we thought it was the battery. And I replaced the battery, because I have a lithium cell battery on there, and when I replaced it, it actually stopped and it fixed it. But now it's happening again, so I don't know if I just bought some garbage batteries, because these are like Ace Hardware, $3.99 for 9 batteries. These are cheap China junk. You know, I wouldn't be surprised if this battery's bad already. So I don't know. I'm going to try replacing the battery again and see what happens. But this is a new problem here. I don't know why this game is resetting. No RAM errors detected. I push the button here, it goes through the boot sequence, no errors, and then we get this, let's see if we can get out of this. And then, no CMOS, so it's going through the test. Let's get out of here. Oh, shut up, come on, get out of here. See, look, oh man. This looks like a RAM issue now. That's new. That did not look good. So I don't know what's going on. I might have to reseat some chips or something. It could be something stupid. Okay, it just reset. So something is up with the Robotron. Not good. So it is whack-a-mole down here, guys, a little bit. But that's new. Look at this. Initial tests indicate RAM error. I don't know, I might pull the game out and maybe reseat some stuff and see if that fixes it. But that game's been actually fairly reliable. I've had that game, well, I guess I've had it for about a year. Has it been a full year already? But it's been okay. I haven't really had any issues with it. I don't know the condition of the power supply. But anyway, all right, guys, that's gonna do it for me in this video. I hope you enjoyed it. I release new videos on Sundays and sometimes in between. This is my Sunday video. If you guys want to keep up with the videos, you got to click subscribe. And then also check out my podcast, Video Game Outsiders, at videogameoutsiders.com, and Arcade Outsiders at arcadeoutsiders.com. And we should be doing an Arcade Outsiders podcast this Thursday, which I think is the 17th, and we'll be doing it on Google Hangouts. I will be posting a link to that at arcadeoutsiders.com. So just stay tuned. Let me make sure Joe and Sean are actually going to show up on Thursday. And if I know they are, I'll put a link on there, and then hopefully you guys can show up. And I'll also release it as an audio podcast on our feed. So, and of course, we have Grinker's tournament coming up October 9th and 10th in Eagle, Idaho. I hope you guys can make it. It is an Arcade Outsiders Grink Fest. Joe, Sean, and myself will be there. We're expecting a great crowd. Grinker's is a barcade. So if you guys can make it there, it's going to be awesome. Go to arcadeoutsiders.com. I have all the details. All right, guys, that's going to do it for this video. I will see you very soon. Later, and bye.